Hi, I'm Vicki Hoth from Handi Quilter, and today I have Kimmy Brunner with me.
Yay!
And Kimmy, a while back you did a webinar on straightening your quilt, loading it, and there were a lot of questions. And so we invited you back to answer the questions. So
awesome.
I'm going to turn this over to you, and then I just want to ask questions along the way.
Yes, please do.
So it's your show.
Oh, yay! As Vicki said, recently we did a webinar, and a lot of people had questions about the stabilization process of working through the quilt. The webinar discussed keeping your leader straight and loading your quilt so that it would be straight, and then I referenced doing stabilization work while quilting. And a lot of people were kind of lost on what is stabilization work. So today we'll talk about stabilizing your quilt, kind of some tips and tricks that you can use to make your quilt turn out a little bit better.
And you can always get it better on a video. So that's rather than sending you pictures and, you know, doing something like that in a PowerPoint, just seeing it real life is so important.
Exactly. Yes. And being able to ask questions and get in there with the camera and say, do this, don't do that.
Okay, so where do we start?
All right. As you can see, I've already got my backing and my batting loaded on.
So I see you have some tube and grip similar to leader grip or red snapper, the way you loaded it onto your top, you know, to the take-up pole, and I'm assuming onto the backing pole.
Yes,
yes. And that's only for your backing.
That's only for my backing. Then I use the rod and grip system a little bit differently. I don't load my quilt tops onto the machine using the rod and grip system, simply because if I have any fullness at all in my quilt's border, I can't ease that in using the rod and grip. You just have to kind of lay it into place with those and snap the clamps down. You don't have any wiggle room like you do when you pin. When you're pinning, if you have any excess fullness in your border, you can ease that in as you go. You can make your quilt be the correct width without creating the pleats that you would get if you just laid that fabric down on the rod and snapped it in place.
And I'm not very good at getting them straight.
I'm the same way.
So
when I'm loading my quilt top, I'm always going to pin the bottom of my quilt onto its leader and roll it up out of the way, simply because that's like having another set of hands coming in and holding on to the bottom of your quilt.
So you're not a floater. You're not
you don't float
this and just let it hang down.
No. The only time that I would do that is if it were a small quilt that I pieced and I know I was really, really careful and I got it really straight and I have
fullness. Because you know what you have.
Absolutely.
Or
if I'm working for customers and I'm working with someone who I know is very meticulous in their piecing, and I know darn well her quilt is going to lay really flat. Otherwise, I want to pin the bottom of my quilt top onto its leader, roll it up out of the way, baste the top of my quilt into place, and then I've got that extra set of hands holding everything nice and flat, so that all I have to do is worry about quilting it.
And it's out of the way so the cat haircut doesn't get on it.
Yeah, and I don't snag it with a pin or
step on it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm a believer in not floating. I pin everything except for like the small something that would be in the throat space.
Yes, absolutely.
I like that stability.
Absolutely. It is. I just find that I get better results. I know that some people get great results floating, and if they get good results, they should continue to do so, but I get better results when I don't.
Yeah,
do
I find that too.
But before I load this quilt top onto the machine, I want to do some detective work because the whole purpose of the detective work is finding out if I've got problems with this quilt before I load it. I do not want any unpleasant surprises when my quilt is on the frame.
Okay.
Once your quilt is on the frame and you haven't figured out what problems you might have with this quilt, it's all going to be guesswork and conjecture. All you can see is this much quilt in front of you. If you start seeing some fullness, you don't know, is that fullness going to get worse? Is it going to get better? What's going to happen with this quilt? I want to look at the quilt before I load it, and I want to know what I'm dealing with before I have
So if I have a Lone Star quilt and it has that big swell right in the center where all those points come, we know we have some issues that we have to work with.
Exactly. Or if I've got
a ribbly border.
Yeah, or wonky corners, or if I'm working on a sampler quilt and it's got 12 blocks and 11 of the blocks are awesome and one block is awful, I want to know about that awful block before I get all the way through.
So if you were quilting for a customer, she brings your quilt and her quilt to you, and it has some of dog ear corners or wavy borders or things that maybe she could correct. Would you correct them or would you send it back home to her?
What would you do? I would offer her some options. I would tell her maybe she should not have pieced the extra 7 inches into the border. Maybe it would have been better if she cut it to shape. I'll give her the options. I can fix that for you, and I will charge you X amount of money, because remember, if you're working on her quilt, she's paying you. Otherwise, you work on your own stuff. Or I will give her the option of sending it home and she can fix it herself. But when I do this, I want to be really careful about how I do it. I don't want to crush her spirit. I'm not telling her her quilt is stupid and so is she. I'm just telling her that we have a little problem and here's how we're going to fix it. And if, especially if it's a brand new quilter, I'm going to walk on eggshells when I explain this to her. And if it's a brand new quilter and it's her first quilt, I'm a softie, so I might just fix it for her so that she gets good results.
So if you fix it for her, will you show her how?
Absolutely. So she doesn't make the same mistake next time.
Yeah. Okay. Yep. Good idea.
And I will show her how much better. I will present it to her in a way that I'm showing her how much happier she'll be with her quilt and how much better her quilt will look, rather than, oh, this is wrong and you did it all wrong.
You're such a peacemaker.
You have to be nice to
Mom. Peacemaker.
Yeah, I get it. I see where you went there. So the detective work that I'm going to do is I'm going to start by measuring the quilt, and I'm going to measure it a couple of times through the center, because I want to know how wide is this quilt. Really, I don't care what the pattern said that it should, the width that it should be.
Okay.
I want to know how wide my quilt is. The pattern designer probably has a different seam allowance than I have. She probably pieces differently than I piece. She probably irons differently than I press my, I use a lot of starch and I press carefully. Maybe she's more aggressive with her pressing than I am. So her measurements are probably going to be different. So I don't care what her pattern says the quilt should be width-wise. I'm going to measure through the center a couple times and see how big the quilt is.
Why the center? Why not the outside edge?
I was just going to get to that.
Oh, sorry.
Don't steal my thunder. When I get to the outside, I'm not going to just measure like right through here along that top stop border.
Okay.
I'm going to measure the edges of my quilt, because the edge of that border is what I'm going to pin to my leader. I want to know what I'm pinning to my leader. So if she, let's say this was the top border and there was a little bit of fullness, she may have eased that fullness in when she stitched this seam, but there's nothing easing the fullness in out here.
Yeah.
So I want to know how wide is this piece of fabric that I'm going to pin onto this leader. So I'm going to measure right along the edge, and I'm going to measure through the middle.
Do you find that outside edge is usually always wider than the center?
If there's a problem with fullness in the border, yeah, you're going to see it in the edge right away.
Okay.
And the easiest way to see, especially if you have a customer that you're working with, the easiest way to show both of you, you and her, if there is fullness, is bring the bottom border up to the center of the quilt, lay it in place, and smooth it down.
Okay.
If the border is too big, it's going to extend off the center. Do the same thing by folding the top of the quilt down to the middle and see if there's extra fabric hanging off. That way, if she's standing right with you, she can see my border's too big, and now I know what Kim's talking about when she says we're going to have to ease in fullness. So back to the detective work, I'm going to do my measuring. If I have several different dimensions, for example, this is supposed to be a 90-inch quilt. Let's say the outside border is 91. The center, the smallest measurement that I take is 89.5, and maybe the bottom border is 92. I need to ease that 91 and that 92 into 89.5, because
smallest.
I can't stretch that 89.5 out to 92 inches. You can't stretch your fabric.
That's an inch and a half.
Yeah, that's a lot of it. That's a lot of stretching. And it may look like it's staying put while you're working on the machine, but as soon as you take it off the machine, it's going to just suck up and take all
the other
layers.
So the stitching's not going to hold it out.
Nope.
Of course, your stitching usually helps draw it in.
Yes, exactly. So you'll be able to easily ease in that excess where you can't stretch out the minimal measurement.
Okay. So if the top of this was 92, the bottom of it was 89.5, would you put the widest at the top or at the bottom? Or does
if I know that one end is worse than the other, I want to do that first.
Okay.
I want to defeat that that problem first. So I'm going to load the worst end first.
Oh, okay.
And that way the whole rest of the thing is like, ooh, we're getting towards the end. It's way better now. So I don't want to save the worst for last, because then you're dreading it the whole time you're working on the quilt. Just fix it and get it out of the way.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Okay. All right.
The other thing I'm going to be looking is, which way are my seam allowances pressed, especially out in the borders?
Mm-hmm.
If my, on this quilt I've got this little black and white stop border and a white outer border. I want to know where those seam allowances are going, because if my seam allowances are pressed to the outer border, I'm going to want to float my border design in from the edge just a little bit, because when my seam allowances are pressed out, you've got a little bit of extra bulk right
mm-hmm,
in there.
Mm-hmm.
If you stitch this line in the ditch and you bring your border design right up to that stitch in the ditch line, sometimes you know how you get that little crease and
mm-hmm.
a little pucker in there?
Yes.
It's because you've got a couple extra inches or a couple extra layers of fabric laying right up next to that stitch in the
okay.
ditch line. So I want to know where my seam allowances
are going. Kind of makes it shift into it.
Yep. So if my seam allowances are pressed into that stop border, I can bring my border design right up to the stitch in the ditch line and not worry about any bunching, any puckering, anything like that. I also want to look for stray threads, because with this little black and white border, I don't want black threads laying
yes.
under my white fabric. I want nice, clean, crisp mm-hmm. white threads. I'm going to look behind the blocks, because I want to know how the seam allowances are looking back there. Do they look bunchy? Do they look messy? Or do they look nice and flat? If there's a bunchy mess where a whole bunch of seams come together, I want to know that ahead of time so that maybe I'm not trying to stitch right into that bunchy mess.
Okay.
Maybe I'd keep my stitching out a little bit. Or maybe I'm going to see that, wow, this is going to give me a lot of fullness. I better get in there and nail it down with some stitching. So moral of the story is I want to get in there and I want to look to see what I've got on this quilt before I start loading it. Does that make sense?
It does. I just worry about that quilter that decides to make this one really flat and this one has a bunch on it, you know?
Yeah, and that's
inconsistent.
That's part of the detective
pressing.
Work. If you've got one that's a train wreck, you have to treat them all like they're a train wreck. You don't want to, if you get four blocks, one of them is a mess, you don't quilt three of them one way and quilt the fourth one differently. You quilt them all as if they were a mess so that they all are consistent when they come off of the
machine.
They're
a consistent mess, huh?
Absolutely. If it's going to be a mess, make it really, really messy. Okay, one more thing. As you can see, I've got white, nice crisp white batting, and I've got a nice crisp white quilt top.
So it's going to be nice crisp white.
Yep, I want it to be white. If you have a white quilt, you want to keep it that way. So you want to think about things like, what color will your backing fabric be? Because if you look at this already stitched example, I've got a lime green backing fabric. And if you look closely, you can see in my heavily quilted areas, I've got a lime green shadow.
I can
up.
See it.
Yeah. So if you want a white quilt when you're done, think about what color backing you're going to use. And think about what color batting you're going to use. You want it all to work together to keep your white quilt white.
White.
So think ahead and don't have any unpleasant surprises later. So any questions about all that detective work and all that stuff?
I think this is great.
It's a like 2-minute process.
So do you go and trim her threads if she's got some lots
yep.
of mm-hmm. back threads?
Yep. Yeah, because you know that she's going to think that she pressed it perfectly and I made those threads appear. So on a little mess like this, I'm going to get in there and just snip those black threads away and make
okay.
it look really, really
okay.
the way that I want it to look before I ever start stitching. Because otherwise, you need to try and get in there with a little tiny crochet hook and pull
mm-hmm.
those threads out. It's way easier to trim it before you load it.
So do you starch your quilt top before you quilt it?
I starch my fabric before I piece it, and that helps me increase my accuracy and it helps me get a flatter
But
finish.
You don't do another starch at the end
nope.
with it?
No,
okay.
because
so
I've
just a good press.
Yeah, I've carefully starched, I've carefully pieced, I've carefully pressed, so it's going to end up
okay.
pretty flat. And I use a liquid starch, a good old-fashioned liquid starch like Grandma used. I mix it either 3-to-1 or 4-to-1, so four parts water to one part
okay.
starch or three parts water.
And then
water.
Just spray it on.
And then just spritz it on. If I have a really flimsy fabric, I'll do the 3-to-1,
uh-huh.
a little bit stronger starch mix. If it's just a good quality quilt shop fabric, 4-to-1.
So the other night we were talking about the way you starch, and you mentioned that you start on the back side of the fabric
mm-hmm.
and you starch that first.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I lay my fabric down on my pressing surface. I have a great big wide pressing surface. Lay it down face down, right side down.
Mm-hmm.
I starch the back. I let it soak in for maybe 2 minutes. I flip the fabric over and I press from the front because the heat of the iron brings the starch up through the fabric, so you get a crisper starch.
So you starch the back, but you don't press the back.
Right.
Okay.
And that also helps cut the flaking, because I hate, like, when you spritz starch,
mm-hmm.
like if you're using, like, this quilt behind us, if I were to spray starch on the right side, I'd have little white flakes
yes.
all over my dark
okay.
purple fabric.
Okay, so you will have the flaking, but it'll be on the wrong
yeah,
side.
Yeah, it'll be on the back, and nobody will ever see it, so.
Oh.
I don't care.
Whoa, what a great tip.
Yeah, don't put it on the top or you'll be sorry later. So, any questions before I start pinning on?
No, I'm excited to see the next step.
Awesome, let's get this pinned
in. All right.
Okay, as you can see, we pinned on the bottom of my quilt top onto its leader. We eased in any fullness that we may have needed to ease in, and we discussed how to do that in the Straighten Up webinar.
Okay.
How you would ease. How you would place your marks or place your pins so that you know where your corners belong. And
so measure out so far mm-hmm. from the center and both
yep,
sides.
Yep, match the center of your quilt border to that center pin, match the corner to this pin, match the other corner
and
to this pin.
And work it between.
Mm-hmm. If you've got fullness, you don't shove it all to the end and try and ease it all in the last 3 inches. You
okay.
ease it in equally as you go.
So maybe find equal parts and then just ease that. That's just
absolutely.
Like you would gathering a sleeve.
Absolutely,
or,
yeah.
Okay.
If you've, and that you only need to do that if you've got really a lot of fullness. Like if this was really a poorly pieced quilt and you've got just a lot of fullness that you're trying to ease, then you may wish to subdivide the border into
okay.
quarters or
mm-hmm.
even eighths.
Or send it back to the quilter.
Or send it back to the quilter, yep.
And
if you have to subdivide the border, remember you want to place corresponding pins on the leader, so that you have a pin on your border to match up to the
okay.
pin on your leader, so that everything is going to be equally
mm-hmm,
eased.
Mm-hmm.
You don't want to have a whole bunch of fullness just shoved into one spot. You want it to be
okay.
evenly, as we said earlier, evenly a train wreck. Make it all a train wreck. It's going to be a train wreck. So now we're going to baste a straight line that is going to attach the batting to the backing and give me a nice straight line to line up my quilt
okay.
top to.
So is there a reason? I noticed, you know, that you have this attached with the tube and the, or the rod and the channel,
mm-hmm.
but you, and so there's a lot of extra backing fabric. Do you always bring it, or do you have your tube and channel?
Yeah, I usually have that down here, but I have, this is like way more backing than I need to have.
Okay.
So I thought it would be more attractive on camera if I just rolled
oh,
it up out of the way.
But normally you'd be a little bit more, not so generous with your backing
fabric. Not so
fabric.
Generous, but that's a great question. I'm gonna be working on this quilt top with templates in my border. And I want to make sure that my clamps are way far away from the edges of my border. I don't
oh.
want to have clamps right up next to where I'm trying
oh, yeah.
to work with
that's
templates.
Not.
Because then I'm trying to balance a template on top of a clamp, or I'm trying to work around a
and the ruler
clamp.
Base hits
mm-hmm.
it.
And I don't.
Okay,
I don't
so you're okay
with
allowing
with
a lot of extra fabric
yes.
just for the ease of quilting?
Yes. If
that's
I'm
a great
not
idea.
Using rulers, I'll have maybe 2 to 3 extra inches on both sides, 2 inches or 3 inches over here, 2 or 3 over here.
Okay.
But when I'm using templates, I want 4 to 6.
Oh.
I want those clamps way out of the way. It may seem like a waste of fabric, but it's easier. I would prefer to waste that fabric and know that I'm not going to be crashing into any clamps or
yeah.
or messing with my rulers.
Okay.
At all, so
just questions along the way here.
Absolutely. I'm going to be using the electronic channel locks.
The electromagnetic channel locks from Handi Quilter.
Yep.
If you don't have a pro stitcher, this is the most awesome thing to have
yes.
added to your machine. And it fits all of our frames
yep.
or all of our machines.
Yep. And it couldn't be easier to use. You just bring up your bobbin thread. You just
turn it to the horizontal.
Flip a switch. Mm-hmm. 2 lines is the horizontal lock. 1 line is the vertical lock. And then you just hit go. And your machine can't do anything but move from side to side or from front to back.
So you're squaring this straight up with the frame.
Straight up. Absolutely straight up. And I'm just basting down my batting to my backing.
Okay. I'll just step back here and let you get all the way over there.
Don't want to run you over. when you get to the other end, pull up your bobbin thread, and then don't forget to turn your channel lock off.
So the zero in the center of the channel lock
is off.
Yeah, so I'm gonna just show this. If I can turn this over and see, the one line is vertical, mm-hmm. so forward and back.
Mm-hmm.
The zero unlocks both, and the two line is horizontal.
Yes.
And that's easy. And I like to take it and actually just hold it in my hand. If I'm doing like piano keys, I'll hold it in my hand and just go back and forth.
Oh, what a good idea.
I know, it's pretty nice.
Yeah,
anyway,
it's
okay.
Pretty smart.
All right, so we have that straight line across. It's like hanging wallpaper, plumb line, right?
Yes, one perfect line to line up everything with.
So you stitch on your batting first.
Mm-hmm. And I'm going to grab my measuring tape. I'm gonna measure this border so you can see how I do this. This is 27 inches wide, so I'm gonna divide that in half.
So
can you grab me the pin cushion, Vicki?
Oh, I thought you wanted me to get the calculator.
Yeah. I can do that math. That's not that hard. So half of 27 is 13 and a half inches. Thank you. I'm going to pop a pin right down in the center.
Of there. So how do you know that that's the center?
I can see where the center of my leader is and the center
of the because
of
the poles
mm-hmm.
that
can,
are right there. There's
yeah.
a lot. Oh, okay. Yeah. So if you couldn't see that, what would you do?
I would have, I would have figured out ahead of time where the center of
like
my
like use some type of a ruler from the center
mm-hmm.
from that.
Or normally, as we just talked about, usually if I were doing this at home, I would still have some of my leader in the workspace.
Okay, so you'd see
so,
that.
So yeah,
center.
I would see my center mark right
okay.
up, just a couple of inches above
right,
where I'm
just
basing
trying
this line.
To figure out every
step of the way. So now I'm going to measure out 13 and a half inches, pin, and I'm going to measure out.
27,
and there's a pin.
Just poking a pin down.
Yep,
and that
that's
was
all
it.
I'm doing. That's it.
Okay.
The pins tell me where to go.
All right.
And now I'm going to lay my quilt top in place.
Right along the edge of that.
Right along that seam or that basted line. I'm going to line up my corner.
Do you baste or do you change it to a basting stitch?
Normally I baste, but you can do it at 10 stitches per inch. It doesn't matter. All you're doing is nailing this into place about an eighth of an inch in from the edge of the quilt
okay.
because you want this basting line to be swallowed up in your binding seam
yes.
allowance. You don't want to have to come in later and mess with.
Now, are you going to pin this down or just hold it like it is?
Nope. With a nice flat batting like this, it's going to stay put all by itself.
Okay.
If I had a fluffy like a high loft poly bat,
mm-hmm.
I would use my glide foot and I would maybe drop a couple of pins in just so that
okay.
it does not shift
okay.
at all. And once again, I'm going to set my channel lock by lining up on the inside of my hopping foot. I'm going to line up the edge of this fabric with the inside of
okay.
my hopping foot.
Okay.
So I know I'm only about an eighth of an inch away
mm-hmm.
from the edge of the quilt. Drop my needle. Set my channel lock. Bring my thread up. And I'm going to just stitch the edge of my quilt into place. Perfectly
okay.
straight line.
So then you can hold that and adjust that.
Yep, and if you have any fullness that you need to ease in, you can walk your fingers behind your hopping foot and just gently tug and smooth, and it gently moves the fullness.
Okay, let's see that. Let's see that on camera as you walk that.
Just gonna kind of walk behind
okay.
it and tugging it as I go.
All
just
right.
gently tugging.
So it keeps that fullness out and
mm-hmm.
definitely want to get those pins out of the way.
Yeah, don't be stitching over pins or won't you be surprised when you hit one. And this one's pretty flat. I don't have much fullness to ease in. I'm just gonna smooth it out of the way all the way to the end.
Back here and let you get this job done.
Didn't mean to run you over.
So you want that corner right up to that line.
Mm-hmm.
And I see you do a little back stitch there,
yeah,
so it doesn't pull out.
I don't want it shifting. I just
want to stay put.
And once again, remember to turn off your channel lock.
Now you can move your machine in any direction.
Yeah. If you don't turn off your channel lock, you're going to start trying to do stuff, and you're not going to be able to do much at all because your machine's not going
to. So if you don't have the electromagnetic channel lock, we do have the channel lock, the plastic C-clamp channel locks that you can put on your, not clamps, but plastic, the little.
They're like little clamps, little C-clamps.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Now I'm going to roll up my quilt top.
Keep my hands, I just like, oh, I want to help.
Don't touch my white quilt.
And now
everything is nailed down. It's pinned on or basted on at the width that it is supposed to be.
At the top.
Mm-hmm. And now.
So how am I going to keep all of this from inching in?
I will show you
in the next step. We're excited. So Kimmy, I see that you have advanced this forward a little bit so that we have some throat space to. Mm-hmm. Attach, you know, to stitch down the sides. Mm-hmm. I'm assuming you're going to do that.
Mm-hmm.
But I have a question. What about quilts that have uneven edges, like double wedding ring or scallops or zigzag type things? How do you line those up and square them up?
Every quilt is going to have some straight lines. You just have to sometimes look a little bit harder to find where your straight line is that you're going to line
up.
Let me show you an example. On this double wedding ring table runner.
I don't see any straight lines, Kim.
Yeah, when you look at this, you just see these curves and these little points, and it's like, well, what do I line up here? But if you look right through here, there's a straight line from this point to this point. There's a straight line across this melon, and a straight line from this point to this point, and a straight line across this melon.
Yep.
So you could fold this down to a straight line right along those lines that we just talked about. Over here and grab this, and let's say this is just the top because obviously this is already pieced.
Mm-hmm.
You would line up that straight folded line against your basted line, get it all nice and flat. And remember, if you're going to do this, when you are basting your batting to your backing, you need to make sure that you leave enough room for this to get
laid down.
So here would maybe be the top edge of your batting. And your basting line would be down a couple of inches.
And it would be a real basting then, because you'd be taking it out
later. Yeah, you'd have to pull it out later.
Okay.
Obviously, the part of the basting that is inside the quilt could stay. You would want to make sure that it's going to be a thread that's not going to shadow through. But the basting thread on the back of the quilt, you could just pull out later.
Okay.
So you'd line up that folded line with your basted line, carefully line it up into place, lay these scallops back, and baste once again right along that straight line to hold it in place.
Okay.
Then come back in and baste up and over the rings and up and over the rings.
Okay.
And now your quilt is straight, even though your quilt didn't look like it had anything straight to line up.
Yeah. Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yes, totally.
Awesome.
Yeah, a little bit more preparation, but in the end it's going to work out.
Absolutely.
Because you took the time
to
prepare.
Yes, nice straight square quilt, even though it doesn't have any straight edges.
Okay.
So next step is going to be, I want to make sure that my top two corners are nice and square. I do not want to start working down this quilt and leave myself dog-eared, funky-looking corners at the top.
Mm-hmm.
If you can get your edges straight and your corners square, everything else on the rest of the quilt looks better because the outside looks better.
Yes.
So the first thing that I'm going to grab is just a rotary cutting ruler.
Okay.
Rotary cutting rulers have nice long lines and they're nice and straight. You can line everything up with a nice long line. I'm going to lay this down on my corners and I'm going to line up the top edge of my quilt with this nice long straight line, and I'm going to line up the side of my quilt with this nice straight line.
And I see it, you're going to have
to tug just a little bit. I'm going to do the same thing over on this side.
Would you place a pin here once you got it in, or
I would baste it once I got, and I'll do that in just a second.
Oh, okay.
I'm going to make sure that this, because when I tugged over here, I want to make sure I didn't shove
anything.
Okay.
Should I hold this, or let you just do
your
thing?
I'll go back and check it one more time.
That's good.
Yeah, it didn't shift at all. It stayed put.
And that one's good.
Mm-hmm. This one's good.
Oh, okay.
So the next thing I'm going to do is bring my machine over, and I showed how to baste that top line using the channel locks.
Uh-huh.
But for those viewers who don't have a channel lock, I'll just show you how I do it without it. Once again, we'll just bring up that bottom thread. I'm gonna bump my stitches per inch down to about 6.
Okay.
And I'm just going to carefully.
Just walk that down there.
Yep. And when I checked that corner, I wanna make sure that it's coming straight down from that corner. And we won't waste time doing that on the, when we're filming, but at home I would have checked to make sure that I've got a straight edge coming down towards my belly bar both ends. I'm gonna baste it into place. I'm gonna do the same thing on the other side, basting those sides in.
So you'll do the whole throat space of that? Okay.
Right till I run into the belly bar and I'm out of room and I can't go any further.
Okay.
And now my whole, everything.
This throat space is square.
Yes, everything in front of me is nice and square. I don't have to worry about straightening those sides out. They are straight, my corners are square.
So I noticed you didn't put the clamps on before you did that.
Nope, because if you clamp your backing fabric before you have basted your top fabric to your backing fabric, making it all one unit, you will be applying unequal pressure, or I'm sorry, unequal tension to the backing and the top fabrics. And if you baste your backing fabric and your top fabric is not stitched down, you're gonna have looser top fabric, tighter backing fabric. Mm-hmm. When you take the quilt off the frame, because the backing fabric was tighter, it's gonna pull your quilt top to the back, and you're gonna have edges that curl around to the back. If your top fabric is tighter than your backing fabric, when you take it off the frame, it's gonna shrink up and it's gonna pull those, the backing right up with it and curl around to the front.
Do you put your clamps on your backing and your batting?
Yep, well if my backing or my batting is wide enough to be hanging over the edges, yeah, then I just clamp those two, but I don't clamp the quilt top.
Okay,
I just clamp whatever's hanging off the edges.
Okay, what's next?
Well, we've basted the top into place, we've basted the sides down, we made sure that those corners were straight, and then we put our clamps on.
Okay.
We wanted to make sure that everything was equally tight, but not too tight. We don't want to turn it into a trampoline.
So I don't have this pulled really tight here. No. And I noticed you've loosened this so that it doesn't bounce. It's just laying on the bed of the
Yes. The
base.
Biggest mistake that people make, and I think oftentimes beginners have this problem, is they over-tighten their quilt sandwich. And then they start having skip stitches, and it just, you will get much better results if you don't have it so tight.
Yeah.
I like to be able to reach up under the quilt with one finger, poke it up from underneath the quilt and grab the tip of my finger. I don't want to bounce quarters off the quilt. You only need to hold it straight or tight enough so that you don't get puckers. You don't need to have the quilt screaming for mercy. It just needs to be tight enough so that it doesn't pucker.
Well, I know when some quilters have it so tight, whether they tighten the take-up pole or the two back poles here, when they tighten them so tight, the fabric is bouncing so that you can't even see the stitching really.
Yeah,
good.
Absolutely. So. And the tighter it is, the more bounce you get. And especially if you've, perhaps you're working with stencils and you've marked some chalk lines, and if it starts bouncing, you get what I call pounce bounce. Your chalk goes all over the place.
Yeah.
And then you can't see where the marks are actually supposed to be because they've bounced so much and they kind of get shadowy instead of crisp and clear.
Good tip.
I want it to be just a little bit loose, not so loose that it's a great big giant hammock, and not so tight that it's screaming at me to please loosen it up. So.
Okay, no trampolines.
Yeah, absolutely. So the next thing that I'm gonna do is, if you look at this quilt, I've got this white border, I've got this white interior, and I've got a really obvious, very boldly contrasting stop border. This line needs to be straight because it is so visible. And if it's not straight, it's gonna stick out like a sore thumb. And so is this line, and so are these lines. So my first order of business is gonna be get those lines straight before I start doing any stitching in the border or any stitching in the interior.
Stabilize.
And the reason that you want to straighten those lines before you start doing any of your motif work or design work is that if you need to tug a little bit or ease a little bit and you've already stitched your border design, you have no wiggle room. You've left yourself no wiggle room at all. So you stitch the line first if you're going to do custom work and if you're going to stitch in the ditch. If you're just, say, doing an edge-to-edge piece, you're not going to stitch in the ditch, obviously, because you're just doing edge-to-edge.
But you still want to straighten it.
Yeah, so you fiddle with it, you make sure that it's straight, you manipulate it into place, and then you begin stitching.
Well, if I've stitched across the top here, won't this be straight?
Not necessarily. It depends on how it was pieced and how it was pressed.
Okay.
Because this can be perfectly straight on the outside, but if this was pieced poorly or pressed,
okay,
maybe a little bit overly aggressively at one end and not quite so much at the other end, it could be really wobbly.
Okay.
So first thing I'm going to do is, once again, I've got that rotary ruler that works so well on my outside corners. I'm going to do the same thing that I did on the outside on these corners.
Oh, okay.
I'm going to line up this long line along this seam line. I'm going to line up one of these lines on this seam line, and I'm just going to make sure that I've got a nice sharp square corner.
Okay.
And some straight lines. And I'm going to do the same thing over here. I'm going to make sure that that looks nice and straight.
Good
and
job.
It does, looks pretty good.
Yeah.
So once I know that it's straight, I can start stitching. And if I lay those lines down and it's not straight, I may need to get in there and tug a little bit or ease a little bit. I may need to manipulate it just a little bit with my hands to get everything laying where
I want it. So if it was really bad, would you maybe manipulate it and then pin?
Yes,
so that it
absolutely.
Would really
hold
it?
Yeah, so it stays put and doesn't just shift out of place before I want to come back in and start stitching. So now I've used my rotary cutting ruler as a kind of a general straightener, but now I want to use my straight ruler as kind of a fine-tuning tool as I'm stitching.
So your long arm ruler that's thicker.
Yes, my long arm ruler that is a minimum quarter of an inch thick.
Okay.
Any thinner than that, it's going to slip under my hopping foot and cause all kinds of damage. So I'm just going to bring my machine over, start my stitching line right in that corner, bring up my bobbin thread, take a couple of tiny little stitches, and I'm going to position my straight ruler so that it's a quarter of an inch in from the seam line that I'm about to stitch. And because the edge of this ruler is straight, it's going to show me if my seam line is straight. I'm going to see right away if that seam line is doing
is
a serpentine
waving.
Thing. And if it, let's say it's bulging out this way, I'm going to use my fingers to kind of pull it in from this direction. If it's dipping down so that it's going to be shy of where it ought to be, I'm going to come on this side and I'm just going to tug it back into position.
So this is a very slow process. I noticed you you've got the little grips here to hold the sandpaper grips to hold it so it doesn't slide.
Yes. The things that you need to keep in mind when you're using a ruler, whether it's stitching in the ditch or stitching out a design, you need to have something helping stabilize it. You need to have your extended base, obviously. You're not ever going to use rulers without your extended base. And you are going to only stitch on the portion of the ruler that your hand is on. Anything that is out past your hand isn't stabilized. So I'm only going to stitch where my hand is. I'm going to stop and reposition my hand or reposition the ruler.
So when the hopping foot gets over to here where this finger is, you're done.
I'm done.
Stop and either reposition or shift your hand.
Absolutely. I am not, if my hand is here, I have no business stitching.
Do you walk along as you're stitching or do you stop?
I want to stop because I can walk, well, I'll walk a little bit, but only a little bit.
Okay.
Because when you're walking your fingers along, you're kind of moving the template a little bit. And I don't want the template moving when I'm stitching.
Yeah.
If my needle's going up and down, I want my template staying put. I don't want my template going
And you're anywhere. Stitching on the downside of the seam.
Yes, my seam allowances are pressed underneath this little stop border, so I'm stitching on the low side of the seam. Your stitches will disappear much more easily if you're on the low side. And I'm also using a flat thread, and what I mean by that is not a thread with a shiny finish, because that way, if I'm stitching in the ditch and I wobble out of the ditch a little bit, I don't want a shiny wobble. I want a wobble that just kind of disappears.
Just like the fabric, because it's not real shiny.
Yeah. So I'm going to use either a cotton thread or a polyester thread with that cotton finish.
So tell me what stitches per inch you use.
I like to use 10 stitches per inch, simply because if I make a mistake, 10 stitches per inch is easier to rip out than 12 stitches or 14 stitches per inch.
Okay.
I'm kind of picky about my stitches per inch, or I'm sorry, about my stitch in the ditch. I want it to be
really
in
accurate.
The ditch. And I mean, I'm not insane about it, but if it wobbles too far out, I'm going to pick it.
And I've checked your quilts, and she's pretty particular.
So
it's pretty particular. Yeah. I know some people use a 12 or a 14 because they're little tiny short stitches, and if you do wobble it, maybe it doesn't look so out of the ditch.
Yeah, it sinks into your
but
fabric.
If you have to unpick or rip out.
Yeah,
yes.
That's a lot of stitches per inch to be ripping out.
Yes.
So when I'm doing stitch in the ditch or when I'm doing template work, any work that has to be really precise or it's going to bug me, I will choose a stitch length that's easier to rip.
Okay.
It just makes my life easier.
All right, I want to watch you stitch in the ditch.
All right, so what I'm going to be thinking about when I'm using a template either to stitch in the ditch or any other kind of template work, I'm not shoving the template up against my or I'm not shoving the hopping foot up against the template. If you do that, if you really shove your hopping foot, first thing you do is you push your template mm-hmm, out of the mm-hmm. line. So I want to instead just slide and glide, nice and gently. As long as you keep contact between your hopping foot and the ruler is going to keep you on track. So you don't need to shove it up against the
so
ruler.
So another thing I've noticed is that you don't have this all the way up the top by the...
No, I want it close to me.
Close to
me. Yeah. Just like me. Yeah.
Okay.
I want to see what I'm doing, and I have the greatest amount of control when my workspace is no more than 15, maybe 18 inches away from me. I want
but
to
this,
see.
But this, you're only about 8 inches
yeah,
away
yep.
from you.
Yeah. I want to be able to lean over
yeah.
and see what I'm doing.
Almost see on top of it.
Yeah, I don't want to be reaching way
mm-hmm.
far back here.
Okay.
So
I said you're not tall enough.
Yeah. You want to give me a leg up?
Yeah.
I'm just going to stitch you. In the ditch.
So you're like placing every stitch individually.
Yep.
This is a slow process.
Very slow. Now I'm coming up to where I can see that my seam line is kind of blurping out a little bit.
Okay.
So I'm just going to tug a little
blurping,
bit.
Blurping, huh?
I'm kind of blurping. And I'm going to tug just a little bit. Get right lined in.
So you're in precision. Do you like precision over cruise?
I always use precision when I'm working with templates. I do not want the machine to be taking any stitches that I don't want it
okay.
to take. So precision because it stops when I stop. Cruise does not stop when I stop.
Yeah, you are getting those. Oh my goodness.
And I'm going to stop, reposition. Check that seam in relation to my
mm-hmm.
nice straight ruler edge.
I'm just going to lean over
and let's all get our noses in here and see what it's doing. And when you start getting out of line, when you start getting onto the high side a little bit, you'll hear a difference in the sound that the needle makes going through the fabric.
Oh, really?
Because now you're going through, over here, you're just going through two layers of fabric and one layer of batting. If you get to the high side, you're going through a lot more fabric, and
yeah.
it sounds like bang, 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 instead of just
oh, okay.
stitch, stitch, stitch. So listen to what your machine is doing, and it will tell you when you're kind of wobbling a little bit. And once again.
So I have a question for you.
Mm-hmm.
Is this frame, for me, this frame is like the perfect height. I have a feeling this might be a little tall for you.
It's a little tall for me, but if I'm stitching at home, I'm sitting at a tall drafting chair.
Oh, okay. You can adjust your height
mm-hmm.
for, okay.
Yep.
That's really important, too.
Yep. I would rather have it be a little bit high because I have greater visibility.
Okay.
When it's lower, then I'm kind of like trying to peer underneath the needle to see where
All
I'm
right.
going. I want to be able to lean over and see.
So this is going to be really accurate, really square.
Yep. And that's especially important because this is white fabric with a little black stop border, and I don't want it to be wobbly. I want
okay,
it to
so
be straight.
Did you do that back and forth right there? Are you going to break your thread?
Yeah, I'm going to break my thread.
Oh, you're not
going to
work your way
nope.
down here?
Nope. I'm going to get this line straight before
oh,
I start working
okay.
down. And when I start working down the edges of the quilt, let me leave myself a little thread tail here. When I start working down the edges of the quilt, I'm going to keep these, and let me get this snipped and get it out of the way.
So you left a tail, why?
I'm going to bury my thread ends. So when I'm working down the edges, or when I'm working down the length of the quilt, I'm going to stitch these in the ditch as I go. I'm going to make sure that they're nice and straight. I'm going to stitch in the ditch as far as I can go till I run into the belly bar. I'm going to leave some thread tails. And I will tie the thread tails from this stitching line to the thread tails from this stitching
okay.
line,
mm-hmm.
tie them together in a knot,
oh.
and bury my thread ends. And I'll do that as I hopscotch my way down the quilt.
Oh, what a good idea.
So I'm stitching.
Another new tip today. That's great.
Yep, it works like a charm. Why take the quilt off and turn it just to stitch a couple of lines in the ditch? Just stitch them as you go.
Okay.
So we won't cover that anymore. I went through, got this line straight. The next thing I would do is get this line straight, start working down here, and then begin working in that top border. But when I'm stitching in that top border, and here's where we start talking about the stabilization work. I'm not going to do any heavy quilting that would warp any of the rest of the quilt. I want to work through my quilt doing only loose quilting.
The stabilizing.
The stabilizing.
Not loose like 6 stitches per inch, but just the stabilizing.
Yes.
Just the stitch in the ditch.
Yes, no heavy fill, no really tight motifs, only big motifs. So if we look at this quilt as an example.
You got a lot of tight quilting going on.
I've got a lot of tight quilting, and I am not doing it all in one pass.
Yes.
I'm going to start, as you can see, I did some template work, and I created these arch shapes. And then I filled in behind those arch shapes with a lot of heavy quilting. My stabilization work on this pass would just be the arch shapes, not the heavy quilting.
Okay, stabilizing as we go.
Mm-hmm. With my next pass, I've got all these little pebbles and I've got all this micro stippling. Mm-hmm. I'm not doing that the first trip through.
Okay.
I'm only going to do this template work. And that template work was created using just a melon-shaped template. I didn't chalk a line. I used some invisible marking, which I'll show you in just a second. I marked a straight miter line here and a straight miter line here. I put a little mark where I wanted the outside of this arch to be and a little mark where I wanted the inside of the arch to be. Same thing over here. Mark, mark. I marked where I wanted these lines to come together right here. I've got another little mark showing where that little arch goes. And then I just stitched this template work, and I stitched in the ditch a little bit inside the flower. I didn't stitch in the ditch the outside because this is 3D petals, so I didn't stitch that in the ditch.
Fun.
But I used a little circle template to just go up and over, up and over to create a little bit more design work. And then I stitched a little bit more detail work in the center. Then I would start coming down the border, the side borders, and I'd work as much of the border as I could until I ran into the belly bar and ran out of space. And I would have pre-marked those borders ahead of time, so I didn't have to stop and try and measure and know where my center is.
Oh, okay.
I want to mark everything ahead
of time. The distance. So how do you figure out, you just take your, just say I'm going to do this every so many inches, or do you have a special tool?
I'm going to figure out how many inches apart I want to place things, and then I'm going to mark it in the quickest, most efficient way possible. And I find that it's really tedious to use my rotary cutting ruler and mark it, line up my rotary cutting ruler, put a little tick mark, move my cutting ruler over, make a little tick mark. So I got this tool, and how cool is that?
The buttonhole tool.
It is so cool. It's called a SimFlex, S as in Sam, I-M, F as in Frank, L-E-X, SimFlex expanding gauge. And it is meant to mark buttonholes, pleats in a skirt, pleats on drapes. It is meant to evenly mark your fabric. So if you set these 2 points 2 inches apart,
everything's
2 inches apart.
So it doesn't say quilting, but you have just made it
quilt.
So where would you find something like this?
If you wanted to shop locally, which I recommend that people do, if you can find it at a local shop, find it at a local shop and buy it at a local shop.
Okay, good.
And I would not so much look for it at a quilt shop because it's not a quilting tool. You would find it at a general sewing store that specializes in garment sewing or
because it is for garment sewing.
Yes, absolutely. So I'm just going to figure out how far apart do I want these little template shapes to be. I'm going to set the correct distance between two of them, and I'm going to know that all of them are
will be
the proper
same.
Distance.
Oh my goodness.
Then I'm just going to lay it down, and I'm going to take a piece of a mechanical chalk pencil and just tick,
mark,
tick, 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 tick.
Okay.
Move it over and just keep going.
What kind of marking pencil?
I use a mechanical chalk pencil. It's just like a mechanical lead pencil. You push the button on the top, and instead of lead coming out, it's compressed chalk.
Different colors?
Always white.
Always white.
I've heard so many horror stories about pink and blue and yellow not coming out. The last thing that I want to do is carefully mark, carefully stitch, and then not be able to get my marks out. That would just be heartbreaking. So I mark with white. If it's a white fabric and I'm not going to see my marks, I will either use a light pearly gray chalk pencil. My preferred brand is Generals, which you can get at any quilt shop. They always have General pencils. You just want a light pearly gray that will show on your light fabrics, or I do my invisible marking trick. And the thing with white fabric is, if you mark it and remove the marks, and mark it and remove the marks because you stitch things wrong and you have to remark and remark, your fabric starts getting dirty in a big hurry. And it doesn't look crisp and white anymore, and I want it to be crisp and white. So to mark things, for example, we were talking about these arched shapes coming together, and I needed to mark that straight miter line. I don't want to mark a line that I am going to remove and make my fabric look dirty. So what I do, and I found this trick just by accident one day.
Here comes another trick.
This is cool. I was stitching out an egg and dart border using templates, and I stitched in the wrong place.
Okay.
And I ripped my stitches out to restitch, and I looked, and I saw the holes from the stitching line, and I was like,
oh, you didn't have to mark.
I didn't have to mark. They were, and it was just like one of those light bulb moments where I just went, all I have to do is stitch a line of holes, and I've got a marked line. So in this corner where I wanted to put that miter line, I would unthread my machine and just stitch back and forth a couple of times, a nice crisp
line. So do they go away?
Absolutely,
Batik fabric?
Batik, you may need to scratch a little bit with your fingernail or with a clean, soft, like a baby toothbrush.
Then
you moisten it just very slightly and just rub the fabric
Close those holes up.
Close those holes right up.
Good tip.
I mean, you know that your stitch... The stitch holes are always visible when you rip out a line of stitching, so make those stitch holes work for you.
Okay,
so
what good idea.
On this line, I invisible stitched the miter line, and then I just put little crosshair lines of, once again, just empty stitch holes showing where I wanted the point of my arches to be. I didn't have to remove any marks later. My white fabric did not look dirty. It just worked like a charm.
Okay.
So I'm going to work my way through the quilt, doing the same thing with each advance, doing this template work, making sure that these lines are nice and straight. And to get these lines, remember we talked earlier about how I want to stitch in the ditch these lines as I work through the quilt. People always ask, well, how do I keep those lines placed properly? And I have a really cool product. I don't sell this. I just think it's the coolest thing ever. This is by Colonial, as in, you know, Colonial, C-O-L-O-N-I-A-L. And it is a zero center long arm measuring tape. There's a zero in the center, and the numbers go out to the left and out to the right.
All the way and out to 77 on each
77,
side, so that's a 12-foot frame.
Yep, absolutely. And it has these cool little sliders that just zip back and forth, and you can park them wherever you want them to be. So I will use this measuring tape affixed to one end only of the machine.
Because it comes with a little clip to do that.
Yep, and when you first get it, you line up the zero in the middle with the center of your leader. Mm-hmm. So that it is in the center of your work
area. So everything stays centered all the time.
So because you are pinning the center of your quilt to the center of the leader, you want the zero center of the measuring tape to be where the zero center of your quilt would be.
I'm going to just test you and see. Remember, it was 13 and a half inches. Oh, we're good.
Yay.
Okay.
So you can move those little sliders to whatever you might want to mark. You can put a little slider where the edge of your quilt should be. I can put a little slider where this seam line should be and another little slider where this seam line should be. I can, if I've got sashing strips, I can put sliders where the sashing strips belong. If I've got seam lines or motifs, I think they come with like 20 little sliders. You can put sliders from here to Kingdom Come.
And I think, I know you can buy extra ones too.
Yeah.
that.
And then when you're done with this quilt, you shove all the sliders to one end.
So just
and
move it aside and you're done with it. Like when you're ready to quilt, you can also move it away and just start quilting.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because I know some people clip it to both ends and it floats over the top, but I like your technique
of just
bringing it over when I need it. And
tossing it when I'm done.
What a good tip.
I don't like to have it laying on my work surface because I'm a dork, and sooner or later I'm going to stitch it into the quilt, and then I'll be like, oh, that's fabulous, time to buy a new one. So, with each advance, I'm going to check my little sliders.
So you're going to keep
that
distance out from the center all the way down the quilt. Mm-hmm. So then when you get to the bottom, you're not going to have this happen.
Yeah. Yep. And I find that I won't remember where things are supposed to be lined up. I won't remember that this is supposed to be at X number of inches. So the measuring tape works as my reminder. And
what
it just helps
idea.
Me keep it straight all the way down. And when I get to the bottom, everything is, because I kept everything in its place all the way through and I pinned it on straight and square, it's brainless. It's straight
so
and square.
So if a customer doesn't, or if a quilter doesn't have that tape, they could just put a regular tape and kind of do the same thing, maybe write down some markings.
Write some notes. Yeah, get
but
some post-it notes.
That is a great tool.
Yeah, and it's, I think it's well worth the price. It would be a bargain to at twice the price, in my opinion.
Yeah.
So when I get to the bottom of the quilt, I've stabilized my way all the way through. I haven't done any heavy fill work. I've just stabilized. When I get to the bottom, I'm going to stabilize this bottom seam line, get it nice and straight.
The same way you did the top with the rulers.
Same way I did the top, exactly. To get those corners straight, I'm going to baste everything into place. The bottom of the quilt top is now unpinned from its leader,
mm-hmm.
and the whole quilt is mounted only to backing. So now I can roll back and forth,
from
back
this
and
pole
forth.
And this pole.
Mm-hmm. I can roll back and forth as many times as I wish, and I can go back through and do all my heavy fill work, knowing that nothing is going to distort because I stabilized everything.
So what happens if there's some fullness in the center? How do you work with that as you're quilting along?
Oh, I've got such a cool trick. Soup cans.
You're going to stop for lunch?
Yeah, I'm going to stop for lunch. Let's go out for lunch.
Oh, let's see. I'll do, yeah.
When you are trying to ease in fullness, let me get this example out of the way. Let's say I've got a whole bunch of fullness in the center of my quilt. It's really nice if you have someone with you to kind of hold the quilt down to help ease it. But a lot of quilters quilt at home during the day. There's nobody else at home with them. So you can put, if there's not too much fullness, you can put two smaller soup cans, one on either side.
Oh, look what that did.
Yeah, it just helps ease in all the fullness. The more fullness, the bigger and heavier the cans.
I know some people use like water bottles,
and they would be lighter. You could use bigger cans that would be heavier. You can use rolls
number
of Duke paper.
10 can there.
Mm-hmm. You just want to remember when you get to the edge of the quilt, these cans, they're round. They roll along with your machine. So when you get to the edge, you make sure your dog is not laying there because it's going to roll off the quilt and onto your foot or onto the dog. So the more fullness you have, the bigger soup cans you need.
Okay.
So works like a charm. It's
wow,
just like
and everybody has a soup can or some can.
Mm-hmm.
Vegetables, you take your preference.
Yep, that can of green beans that you bought a year ago and nobody in your house likes green beans, so there they still are. And it's just like having someone there to lay their hands down and help
what
you
a good
ease
idea.
Your fullness in.
What a good idea.
Works like
any
a charm.
Any fun? Are we, like, we've got it.
You've
I think
got
we've
it.
Got it.
I think you've got it. It's just, the key is putting it on there straight, keeping it straight as you go through. Don't do any kind of stitching that is going to distort your lines until you get those lines nailed
Stable.
Down. Straight lines, straight and straight lines first. And then everything else comes after
that.
Oh
my gosh, this has been so informative. Thank you, Kimmy.
You are very welcome.
I am so happy to have you in our studio at Handi Quilter.
Thank
you so much.
Let's go out for lunch and have soup. What do you think?
Kimmy, thank you for joining us at Handi Quilter.
You're very welcome.
There is so much information here. Our quilters are going to really have square quilts now.
Awesome. It really makes a big difference. The thing to remember is it doesn't take you any extra time. You're doing exactly the same steps. You're just doing them in
Accurate.
A slightly different order.
That's
it
true.
It gives you better results. So it's not like you're spending 3 hours extra quilting. You're just doing the same quilting in a different
yes.
order.
Well, thank you. Results. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank
and
you very
we
much.
And we will see you again.